Bible study. I'm Dr. Randy White, and we are in the book of Daniel. We've been talking these 6-7 weeks now. This is session 7 about the future of the Gentile reign and of the Jewish remnant, and we are looking at what happens in the times of the Gentiles. Daniel is a Jewish prophet speaking to the Jewish remnant, but he gives so much information. It is keystone kind of information. You've got to have this information for understanding the times of the Gentiles or the times of the Gentile reign that you and I live in. Now, the Gentile reign really began with the loss of the sovereignty of the Jewish nation with the exile of Daniel in about 605 BC, and it extends all the way to this day and even beyond until after the rapture until the king sets up his kingdom. The King of Kings sets up his kingdom. And that, of course, was in Daniel chapter 2. Now, with that, we come tonight to Daniel chapter 5, which is, there's an incident in Daniel chapter 5, which you're familiar with and you'll understand, and we're going to look into it and perhaps bring some additional insight into that tonight. You know, one of the things that I want to do tonight is going to remind you to sign up for our retreat in Branson, Missouri on the ministry of Jesus graphically presented. But what I wanted to do tonight is go through a little bit of a timeline. And let's talk about the book of Daniel and where we are on the calendar. So we back all the way up to Daniel chapter 1, which of course we looked at several weeks ago, happening in 606 BC. Now, it was not until 586 BC, I'll add this to the calendar, 586 BC, that Jerusalem itself fell and was completely destroyed. The temple was destroyed about right here. So there were all these years in here in which Daniel was in captivity, and Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, and the other leading royalty, the nobility of who you were. And we have then his exile, Daniel chapter 1, 606 BC, at the beginning of the reign of Nebuchadnezzar. Daniel chapter 2 was 604 BC, and this was Nebuchadnezzar's dream. Now, what was his dream? Just to remind you, it was this dream right here, which in a couple of weeks we're going to get to Daniel chapter 7 and Daniel chapter 8, and we're going to add some information that goes with his dream of this statue of a man that was gold and silver and bronze and iron and iron and clay. And tonight what we're going to do is actually move from the gold down to the silver of the Medo-Persian Empire, and this is Daniel chapter Chapter 5 that we will look at. And I see I have 538. We could argue about that. I'm going to use the date of 539 today. So we have then in 604, Nebuchadnezzar's dream. In 580 BC, we have Nebuchadnezzar's golden image. Now, this is the image that, I'll get it out here in a moment, the image that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were to bow down to, and refused to bow down to that. Now, we come to 570 BC, 10 years later, 570. So look, I'm not good at math here, but what you got, 33 years, 34 years here from to 570 BC. Daniel has been a leading figure in the kingdom all of this time. Nebuchadnezzar has his next dream. That was the dream we looked at last week, and that was the dream of the tree that was cut down. And we looked at that and understood that. Now, his 7 years of agony began even that year, as we saw, and that's from 570 to 563 BC. In 563, 562, he had a restoration of his reign, but he died in 562. And there was the reign of his son, who in the Bible is called Evil Merodach. Now, I want you to know that even though that sounds probably descriptive of him, The word evil here is actually only coincidentally evil. It's, as we're going to see later tonight, we're going to see the goddess Sin. Now, it is a sin to worship the goddess Sin, and yet it's only coincidental that her name Sin matches with our English word for sin, and it's only coincidental also that his name evil matches our word for evil. So, evil Merodach. He's mentioned in 2 Kings chapter 25. Verse 27, and he's mentioned there from 562 to 560. He had a very short reign. He's mentioned there for releasing Jehoiachin. Jehoiachin was the king all the way back here that was replaced by Nebuchadnezzar and had been kept imprisoned the entire time. The book of Jeremiah also mentions evil Merodach, one of the sons, we believe, of Nebuchadnezzar. Then there was Nergalesser, who served a few years here. He was the son-in-law of Nebuchadnezzar, killed his brother, evil Merodach, in order to gain the throne. So we can see here this head of gold is already beginning to get weak here. Then there is a the reign of this fellow here from in 556, had a very short reign, and quickly he was deemed unfit to reign. And this is where we're going to pick up tonight then with the reign of Nabonidus. I knew I should have practiced this, Nabonidus. And as we see Nabonidus, he spent much of his reign, we're going to learn this tonight, he spent much of his reign in Arabia. And that's important for us to understand as we come to some history that we'll look at later. And while he was in Arabia for about 10 years, honestly, he appointed his son Belshazzar to serve as a co-regent, king of Babylon. And Belshazzar is going to be in our dream now in 539 BC. We're coming to Belshazzar's feast. So all of this right here really fits between 570 and 539. And we're going to just cram it all in there. And this Belshazzar is going to be really, along with Nabonidus, he's going to be the last king of Babylon. Now, I remind you again, Nebuchadnezzar is this head of gold. All of the Nebuchadnezzar that is part of these reigns that we looked at here just a moment ago, and Belshazzar, he's the tip of the beard, I guess you'd say, and we're going to come in now into this silver portion of the reign of the Medo-Persian Empire. And we will consider this together. Greg, I noticed, just asked a question. Do you think it took 24 years for Nebuchadnezzar to collect the gold for the image, or do you think it took that long for the idea of the image to percolate? It is a great question, and as you say, pure speculation to determine, because honestly, we don't know, but it was a long time, and it certainly tells us that that image kind of stuck in his mind. Now, if you remember from Daniel chapter 3, that we were looking in, that image, we believe in Daniel chapter 3, was not the image of a man, but rather a, the name left me, the word left me, what's the Washington Monument, an obelisk. I knew it would come eventually, probably an obelisk that he was having them bow down to. So with that then, let's come into our scripture, and we're going to be at Daniel chapter 5. I will be reading mostly from the King James Version tonight. We've got the Young's Literal Translation here and the Aramaic here. Some of you might be wondering and say, well, Aramaic looks a lot like Greek, and it does look, excuse me, not like Greek. Aramaic looks a lot like Hebrew. They are very closely related, Aramaic and Hebrew, and so this is written in Aramaic. Now, chapter 5, verse 1, Belshazzar the king made a great feast to 1,000 of his lords and drank wine before the 1,000. Here is this this reference to Belshazzar the king. Now, let me just say to you, those like Julius Wellhausen and others, the critics of the scripture, they jumped on this one like a frog on a June bug, actually, because for centuries there was absolutely no record that Belshazzar the king ever existed. There wasn't a newspaper article. There wasn't a recovered text message from the CIA. None of that was available. There wasn't a stone. There wasn't a sign. Nothing. So all the skeptics, of course, said Daniel was wrong. Daniel didn't know what he was talking about. Daniel was making some of this up. Belshazzar wasn't the king. In fact, when we get down to verse 30 and 31, we're going to see that Daniel says that Belshazzar was the last king, and they all knew, all the skeptics knew, that it was Nabunide that was the last king. And so they said, see, Daniel's wrong. Now listen, anytime there's one of these issues, if you'll just be patient, archaeology will eventually uncover it. Don't throw out the Bible because you've got an issue like this. Hang on to the Bible. In fact, you know, it's just so impossible to understand how you've got hundreds and hundreds and hundreds, thousands of things that align perfectly, and yet some skeptic will come along and say, well, Belshazzar was never king. The Bible is completely wrong. Now, that's just, honestly, it's illogical, it's dishonest, it's just agenda-driven for a person who doesn't want to accept the Bible anyway, and this is what the scholars did. And even it was huge scholars in the seminaries, and they were the ones that were undermining the book of Daniel more than any others, and they were saying, well, this was not written by Daniel. This was written hundreds of years later. And by hundreds of years later, they just got it wrong and they messed up and they didn't get it right. And what else is wrong in the book of Daniel? And all that was done, I'm convinced, because in that day, as they were teaching all this, covenant theology was so strong, and kingdom theology that goes right along with covenant theology that says the church is the covenant people of God, the church is the bride of Christ, the church is the kingdom. And that was so strong that they had to make everything align with it. And Daniel just frankly doesn't align with that. When Daniel talks about the kingdom, it doesn't look a thing like the church. And so how in the world were they going to do this? Well, the best thing to do is undermine the historicity of the book of Daniel. And so this is what they did. Well, guess what, however? Archaeologists went and did their work. And in Babylon, they uncovered some things. Here I've got a picture on your outline, Nabonidus Chronicle, and it is in the British Museum today. You can go see the Nabonidus Chronicle. Be sure and practice ahead of time before you ask for it, and it tells about the destruction of Babylon, Cyrus coming in and taking it, and guess what? Lo and behold, Belshazzar the king. They found out that Nabonidus the king, that was again on the timeline, Nabonidus, he was in Arabia. He wrote about it. I've been in Arabia for 10 years. He was kind of in a self-imposed exile, if you will, or some people say a spiritual journey, whatever it was, a military conquest. He was out of the picture. And he puts his son Belshazzar in. And so, for all practical purposes, Belshazzar is the king. So, here it is. Belshazzar the king. Guess what we know now? Well, what we know now is Daniel was right. He was right all along because he was there experiencing it. And so he writes Belshazzar the king. Now he came and put on this great feast. We'll talk about that in a little bit, but a great feast to 1,000 of his lords and drank wine before the 1,000. You remember the story of Esther, of course, and Ahasuerus, the king, in the book of Esther, who was a Persian king. And it seems like these Mesopotamian kings have a little problem when it comes to festivities and partying a little too much. And this is exactly, again, what happened. He is drinking wine. wine. So Belshazzar, while he tasted the wine, commanded to bring the golden and the silver vessels, which his father Nebuchadnezzar had taken out of the temple and which was in Jerusalem, that the kings and the princes and the wives and the concubines might drink therein. Now, therein is his problem, and we're going to show this and display this here. Therein is the problem. But let me just say to you another problem the skeptics have right here. His father, Nebuchadnezzar. Well, again, can I bring you here? Nebuchadnezzar dies back here in 562. And look, he's got a son, Evil-Merodach. He's got a son-in-law right here. And this is a brother of this fella here that ends up. And then this guy, I'm not even going to try it anymore. King N, guess what? As far as we can tell, he's not even related. He's not even of the same dynasty. There's a little bit of a debate upon this, but it looks like this guy's not even related to our friend Nebuchadnezzar. So what's up here when you come and it says his father Nebuchadnezzar? Even if he was related, well, guess what? It's not his father. There's a lot of generations or differences that go on here. And undoubtedly, Belshazzar is not the son of Nebuchadnezzar. So some of the translations put a footnote in that he's actually the grandson, and that's upon, of course, the assumption that his dad is the son, and that there was just a quick period in which there were various sons and sons-in-law on the throne. Now, there is the slight chance that Belshazzar's grandfather was Nebuchadnezzar, because we're not exactly sure of his father's lineage, but I think it's honestly a pretty slight chance. But nonetheless, Belshazzar's not the son of Nebuchadnezzar. But many times in the scripture, and you don't even have to go to the scripture, modern language, ancient language, we speak in these terms. We speak of our founding fathers. The Jewish people, of course, even in the New Testament day, they were talking about our father Abraham. So you let scripture interpret scripture, and there's absolutely no problem here. It doesn't have to be the immediate father here. So this particular version of the King James does have a little footnote here, and he says grandfather here. But again, I have spoken to that. So Belshazzar comes along, and here's his problem. It's a problem of pride, and pride comes along and says, you know, here we are feasting. Let's use the wine goblets, the gold and the silver that came from the Jewish temple. I'll explain here in a little bit that there was something going on here at this time in which they were gathering together all of the various gods, little g, the idols of the kingdom, and they were putting them within the walls of the city of Babylon. So all this stuff is here. He says, hey, let's use some of it, especially that of the Jews. And so they take this. Now, this is where God honestly says, enough. I know we're going here. We're going from gold to silver. Let's speed this up and let's make it happen. So he brings it in again, all these things that the king and the princes and his wives and his concubines might drink therein. Can you imagine the holy vessels of God being used in this drunken party that he's having? So verse 3, they brought the golden vessels that were taken out of the temple into the house of God, which was at Jerusalem, and the king and the princes and his wives and his concubines, they drank in. They drank wine, and they praised the gods of gold and silver and brass, of iron, of wood, of stone, using that which had been created under the instruction of God Almighty, the God of the Jews, and had been dedicated as holy unto him in the house where he said, I will always be attentive to the prayers prayed in this place, and taking those and using them now. It's like, remember the Philistines when they had the Ark of the Covenant, and finally they said, no, we don't want this thing. Get rid of it. And it turns out to they're praising the wrong gods, aren't they? And these idols of gold and silver and brass and iron, wood and stone. And so It happens then that in the same hour came forth fingers of a man's hand and wrote over against the candlestick upon the plaster of the king of the wall's palace, and the king saw the part of the hand that wrote. Now, whether it's just the hand or even it's just the fingers that are holding the quill there, whatever it was that they was writing, it is writing. And I see one of the comments that I just glanced at a moment ago talked about the note of historical accuracy that you see in some of these things. And this is one of them here, that he's writing over against the candlestick on the plaster of the wall. This is detailed. And it's the picture as he's remembering and recalling what happens. So this happened, this same hour that it was brought about. And then the king's countenance was changed. Not Mr. Happy anymore, not Mr. Jovial anymore, but he had no doubt the look like, we would say, he's seen a ghost. He hadn't seen a ghost, he'd seen a hand that was writing on the wall. And of course, still today, we have that phrase, the handwriting on the wall. And you could go anywhere in America and say, what does the handwriting on the wall mean? If someone says, I saw the handwriting on the wall, they'd be able to tell you, it means, uh-oh, time is short. This thing's done with all she wrote. That lady, she is preparing to sing, if you know what I mean. And you could go in the most atheistic college campus in America today and ask them, what's the handwriting on the wall mean? And they'd be able to tell you, and it comes from this chapter right here. So when he saw the handwriting on the wall, his countenance was changed. His thoughts troubled him so that the joints of his loins were loosed and his knees smote against one another. We talked today about, you know, your knees are shaking. And here it is he is definitely come together, and this man is in fear. So the king cried aloud to bring in the astrologers, the Chaldeans, the soothsayers, just like Nebuchadnezzar here. They're still depending all the way on the same ones, and I've been trying to give the argument all along that I don't think Nebuchadnezzar was saved as we talk about it. I don't think later on we're going to talk about Cyrus. I don't think Cyrus, even all the good work that he did, was saved. And sometimes we get, you know, this little passage of scripture that says, Nebuchadnezzar said some good things about God. And so, oh, well, he must have got saved down at the revival meeting at the Baptist church. And we read our own experience into it. But some of these things, like these cuneiforms that were discovered in Babylon, they tell the other things these kings did as well. Like even Cyrus, and Cyrus was one that worshipped all sorts of other gods. Certainly no way that he was ever converted into Judaism and was a believer like that. So here are the kings doing those same things with the astrologers, the Chaldeans, the soothsayers. And the king spake and said unto the wise men of Babylon, you almost feel like deja vu all over again, right? Because this is the third time we've seen this. The king spake, said to the wise men of Babylon, whosoever shall read this writing and show me the interpretation thereof shall be clothed with scarlet and have a chain of gold about his neck and shall be the third ruler in the kingdom. Now, here, King Belshazzar, he knows what it says. He can read what it says. What he doesn't know is what it means. So he needs the interpretation thereof. And, you know, what is this? A handwriter comes and writes it on the wall. I can read what it says, but what in the world does that mean? And he is so frightened over this thing that he offers that the one who can tell me shall not only have these, the clothing of scarlet and the chain of gold, scarlet or purple, it's a word that can mean a reddish purple. Royalty, nonetheless, is what it means. Clothed in scarlet and have a chain of gold around his neck. Yeah, this is a long-standing tradition for royalty. And, of course, in the United States, some of you who are Canadians or Australian understand a little of royalty a little more than we do in the United States. We don't have much of an equivalency of royalty, and especially of royal garments. And yet, in any kind of world of royalty, there is the royal robe and the scepter, and the purple or the red is often that picture of royalty. But you remember Joseph, of course, got his coat of many colors, but also then when he helped the Pharaoh out with the interpretation of the dream, guess what the Pharaoh did? Put upon him the royal robe. Moses comes and he gets the royal robe. Later on after this story in the book of Esther, we're going to see Mordecai, in order to be honored, he's going to be given that robe of the king, and in that case a ring that he's going to wear. In this case, it's a necklace that he's going to wear. But what I want you to note is, it says he shall be the third ruler in the kingdom. Now, if you want to have some fun sometime, go back to the academic critics who denied that Daniel knew what he was talking about, Belshazzar, and see what they say about the third ruler in the kingdom. They'll be given all these reasons why he was the third ruler of the kingdom. But when you understand, there was the father and the son who were the co-regents, and the father was the first king, and Belshazzar was the second king, it makes perfect sense to say, I'm going to make you next. I'm going to make you the third ruler in the kingdom. Again, just a note of complete historical accuracy that is given right here. And so then we come into verse 8, and it says, then came all the king's men, but they could not read the writing nor make known to the king the interpretation thereof. And then was King Belshazzar greatly troubled, and his countenance was changed in him, and his lords were astonied. Now remember, this is the third time that we came to this word in the book of Nebuchadnezzar. It's more than the old English version of astonished. It is literally thunderstruck, or just became stone. Remember Daniel last week in chapter 4, he was astonied when he saw what happened in a single hour, and just was just literally frozen, if you will. And so here's what happens. Now, the queen, it says, by reason of the words of the king and his lords, came into a banquet house, and the queen spake and said, O king, live forever. Let not thy thoughts trouble thee, nor let thy countenance be changed. The queen comes along. We do not know, honestly, who this queen is. We just know she's the queen. We do know that in ancient kingdoms, there really was more than one queen, so to speak. And so was it Belshazzar's wife? Was it his father's wife? Maybe his mother? Because of her understanding of things going all the way back to Nebuchadnezzar, we're thinking that perhaps it is the queen mother. But nonetheless, here is this woman who's part of the royal family, and she comes in and says, hey, be calm. Don't worry about it. Everything's going to be okay. Now, she may even have been risking her life here. Again, remember the story of Esther, which is going to come a few years after this, still in Babylon, however. And it's stepping before the king and not having been given the invitation, but here it is. Whether that happened or not, we don't know exactly here. So it says then in verse 11, there's a man in thy kingdom, the queen says, in whom is the spirit of the holy gods. Remember, we had that last week in chapter 4. And I believe that's verse 9. There's a man, the spirit of the holy gods is in him. That is, she doesn't totally understand it. She just knows it's divine. And in the days of thy father, again, speaking of Nebuchadnezzar, in that generalistic sense, in the days of thy father, light and understanding and wisdom, like the wisdom of the gods, was found in him, whom the king Nebuchadnezzar, thy father, the king, I say, thy father made master of the magicians, astrologers, Chaldeans, and soothsayers. Now, let me just stop and say one thing that I want to give a little footnote to something I've already said. That means I want to question the assumptions. I said earlier how Belshazzar, there's no appearance at all. And in fact, from everything we know, Nebuchadnezzar was not his father. His father in the sense of our father Abraham, yes, but not his genealogical father. Now, I would want to say, however, that archaeological work is still done. And there was a lot of strange things that went on in that kingdom. And there is the possibility even that Nebo, our king here, whose name I can't get at all tonight, Nabonidus, and Belshazzar were both the son of Nebuchadnezzar. And so Belshazzar wasn't then the real son of Nabonidus. Again, we don't know exactly how that works. From what we can tell, it looks like from extra-biblical literature, archaeological discoveries, really not literature, extra-biblical literature, it looks like Belshazzar was the son of Nabonidus, and they were not related to Nebuchadnezzar, other than they were sitting on his throne. So here it comes, and he says the queen mother or the queen says, hey, there's a guy that used to be able to tell, and he was so good that Nebuchadnezzar made him the master of the magicians, astrologers, Chaldeans, and soothsayers. For as much as an excellent spirit and knowledge and understanding, interpreting of dreams. Now, do you remember all the way back from Daniel chapter 1? It says that God gave Nebuchadnezzar this ability to interpret dreams. And that's basically what he's been doing all his life now. So he's interpreting these dreams and showing hard sentences and dissolving doubts. Now, this is an interesting issue here, that dissolving doubts, especially showing hard sentences, that's the educational process we talked about way back in Daniel chapter 1. And dissolving doubts. We don't know exactly how to translate this, because literally it says loosing knots. I believe that's what the Young's literal translation, the loosing of knots. That's the literal translation. So he looses up the knots. Okay, they interpreted that as dissolving doubts. The interlinear in verse 12, says in here, right here, insight, interpreting dreams, and explaining riddles. Dreams interpreting, or dreams explaining, riddles solving, the solving of riddles. So here they've got a riddle going on, if you will. What, I see the letters, okay, I got that, but what is it? What is the meaning of this? And so here's the one who can dissolve the doubts as to its meaning. It can show us the hard sentences. All these were found in the same Daniel whom the king named Nebuchadnezzar named Belshazzar. Close to Belshazzar, but not the same, Belshazzar. Now, let Daniel be called, the queen says, and he will show the interpretation. Then Daniel was brought in before the king, and the king spake and said unto Daniel, art thou that Daniel, which art of the children of the captivity of Judah, whom the king my father brought out of Jewry? Now, it does give the impression here that Belshazzar was not all that familiar with Belshazzar, with Daniel. And the queen understood who he was, or remembered, or recalled, but Daniel seems to have drifted off in all of this switcheroo that was going on in the kingdom. He went off. Now, we can understand, this happens very quickly today, doesn't it? And in the United States, of course, we have a new administration every 4 or 8 years, and sometimes we prefer it, every 2 years or whatnot, but it comes and goes. Now, those who are with the administration, clean house. Boom, there they all go, and new ones come in, and people who were once very powerful in the United States, the way it works anyway, is they're very powerful one day, they're just a normal old ordinary Joe the next day. And so Daniel seems like he was just sort of living in his peaceful little life here. We don't know exactly what all was going. So he says, hey, are you the one brought out of the captivity of Judah, whom the king, my father, brought out of Jewry? Now, I don't really like this interpretation right here. Literally, he says out of the Judeans, and there's a number of places where you'll see this particular term used, which probably was appropriate and worked in 1611 when King James was done. Today, it's not the best way to put it, and there are several times when it's really even inaccurate the way it's used. In fact, we have it in the fifth chapter of the Gospel of John, where it says those who are of the Jewry wanted to kill Jesus. This is in last Sunday's sermon. Those who are of Jewry wanted to kill Jesus, so he went to Galilee. Well, wait a minute. Everybody in Galilee was Jewry as well. They were Jews. They were of the Jews. So what it always means is those who are of Judea wanted to kill him, and so Jesus went to the Jews of Galilee. Now here we have this same issue. His father brought him out of Judea. He was still a Jew. He didn't leave Jewry. He was a Jew even to this day. He just happens to be out of Judea, and was, as Bob says, pulled out of retirement right here. Verse 14, I have heard of thee, Belshazzar, the king says, I've heard of thee that the spirit of the gods is in thee. Again, they're not quite getting this. They just know what he can do. The spirit of the gods is in thee, and that light and understanding and excellent wisdom is found in thee. And verse 15, and now the wise men, the astrologers, have been brought in before me that they should read this writing and make known unto me the interpretation thereof, but they could not show me the interpretation of the thing. And I have heard of thee that thou canst make interpretation and dissolve doubts. Now if thou canst read the writing and make known unto me the interpretation thereof, thou shalt be clothed with scarlet and have a chain of gold about thy neck and shall be the third ruler of the kingdom. Let me say one thing about all of this, and that is that all through Daniel 1 through 5, we've had a lot of repetition. It seems to, you know, say this one long thing and then repeat the long thing. Again, I think that there are two things going on here. First of all, I think that this is a sign that God, even though he inspired his word by word, I believe in verbal plenary inspiration, he still, and how all this works, I'm not sure, but he still lets the personality of the writer come through. And the personality of the writer, and I think even of the culture, was this kind of repetition. And not only that, but you have to remember that Daniel was working in a governmental world, and governmental work is very precise. And so you read a contract, and there's repetition in the contract, just to make sure everything is right here. And I think this is what we have going on with Daniel. So Daniel answered and said before the king, let thy gifts be to thyself and thy rewards to another. Yet I will read the writing unto the king and make known to him the interpretation. He says, I don't need your position. I'm living my happy life over here. He's going to get it, by the way, for a few short hours. But go ahead, leave it there. O thou king, the most high God gave Nebuchadnezzar thy father a kingdom and majesty and glory and honor. Even though Nebuchadnezzar, I think, was never saved again, as we talked about in previous weeks, Daniel certainly had a great deal of respect for him and understood from understanding that head of gold what was going on here. So he repeats some things that we've seen in other chapters. And it says, and for the majesty that he gave him, all people, nations, languages trembled and feared before him, whom he slew and whom he would keep alive and whom he set up and whom he would put down. But when his heart was lifted up, and his mind hardened in pride, go back and read chapter 4, he was deposed from his kingly throne, and they took his glory from him. And he was driven from the sons of men. And his heart was like beasts, and his dwelling with the wild asses. And they fed him the grass like oxen, and his body was wet with the dew of the heavens, till he knew that the Most High God ruled in the kingdom of men, and that he appointeth over it whomsoever he will. Again, a repetition of chapter 4. And thou, his son, O Belshazzar, hast not humbled thy heart, though thou knewest all of this. Everybody knew what happened to Nebuchadnezzar. And he says, you should have had a humility, and yet here you are drinking out of the golden goblets from the temple. This is the utmost of arrogance against God. Reminds me of the guy whose name will come to me in a moment. The father of Babylon, really, the one who founded Babylon. You remember Nimrod. I knew he'd get there. That Nimrod, just he was willing to put his fist in God's face. And it says, look, you're just like Nimrod in the pride that you have. Now, verse 23. I know we're doing a lot of extra reading tonight here, but getting through this chapter. But you knewest all this, but hast lifted up thyself against the Lord of heaven, and they have brought the vessels of his house before thee. Thou and thy lords and thy wives and thy concubines have drunk wine in them, and thou hast praised the gods of silver and gold and brass and iron and wood and stone, which see not, nor hear, nor know, and the God in whose hand thy breath is, and whose are all thy ways, hast thou not glorified. Read that along with Romans chapter 1 sometime, and it'll go along very powerfully. Then was part of the hand sent from him, and this writing was written. And this is the writing that was written, Mene, Mene, Tekel, Upharsin. Mene, Mene, Tekel, Upharsin. Now, the King James, I think, does us a service here in not translating it. That's just the words that were written. If we look in Young's literal translation, Young's takes the approach that they always translate it, and so they translated it. Numbered, numbered, weighed, and divided. That's what those words mean. Numbered, numbered, weighed, and divided. Well, you can imagine if you're sitting there and drinking out of the golden goblets from the temple and having a grand old time, and maybe you're even part drunk, and the hand comes out, you're going to be frightened. It writes on the wall, numbered, numbered, weighted, divided. What does it mean? I don't know what that means. Numbered, numbered, weighted, divided. And there's not an obvious meaning to it. I know you and I think, well, yeah, it's obvious. That's because we've read the rest of the story. You were in Sunday school before and had this. But you just look at that. Numbered, numbered, weighted, divided. If you were driving down the road and you saw a billboard that said numbered, numbered, weighted, divided, I guarantee a lot of people say, what's that all about? I don't understand, though it might be appropriate for our world today. Verse 26. This is the interpretation of the thing. Mene. God hath numbered thy kingdom and finished it. It's all counted off. You're done. Remember when we get to Daniel chapter 9, a very exciting chapter, there's going to be a numbering of the days of the Gentiles. Now here is a numbering of what is going on here with the days of the Babylonian kingdom. Verse 27, Tekel, thou art weighted in the balances and found wanting. Peres, thy kingdom is divided and given to the Medes and the Persians. That is terrifying, isn't it? To go through all of this. And the interesting thing is when he hears the interpretation, he doesn't seem to be terrified anymore. At least it's not recorded in the scriptures. Look what happens in verse 29. Then commanded Belshazzar, and they clothed Daniel with scarlet, put a chain of gold around his neck, made a proclamation concerning him that he should be the third ruler in the kingdom. Now, again, I'm having to read between verse 28 and 29 here a little bit, but there doesn't appear to be this wake-up moment for Belshazzar where he falls down upon his face as the that New Testament parable goes and says, "Oh God, be merciful to me, a sinner." It doesn't appear to be happening. Maybe he has that and it's just not recorded. Or maybe he says, well, you know, at least I know my lot. I know it's coming. And he just swallows and says, okay, here it comes. Or maybe he says, well, now I know what the gods want to do. I'll work against it. I'll just double up my efforts and we'll go out there and we're going to make this thing happen. And Daniel, I promised you third in the kingdom. Here you are. Here's your robe. Here's your necklace. Congratulations. And let's get to work. Whatever it is there, all we know is that he was a man of his word here in this part. And then it says, right in verse 30, in that night was Belshazzar, the king of the Chaldeans, slain. The Chaldeans, of course, the Babylonians. In that night, Belshazzar, king of the Chaldeans, was slain. Now, read verse 31 and then talk about 30 and 31. It says, Darius the Median took the kingdom, being about 62 years old. 62 years old. Darius the Mede. Now, let's talk about the end of the Babylonian kingdom here for just a moment. We know that the Achaemenid, got too many words that I struggle with here tonight, empire, later is known as the Persian Empire, so I'm just going to call it the Persian Empire. We know that it was ruled by Cyrus the Great. And Cyrus had been expanding his kingdom both in the west, east from Babylon, where Cyrus was from, in the modern day Iran, in that area. And he was ruling there, but he was also coming all the way to the other side, to the Assyrians, and he was working in that area, and he was gaining on the Babylonians. And this is perhaps even one of the reasons that the king, Nabonidus, was off in Arabia, maybe trying to shore things up down there, maybe even on the run down there. There's a number of conflicting stories that go here. But we do know that Nabonidus was overly friendly with a whole bunch of gods, little g. And we remember that Nebuchadnezzar was the mouthpiece of the god Nebu, and that's the god Marduk and Bel, later Baal, and all of that was the primary god. But Belshazzar's, what we understand to be his father, he was kind of big on a lot of gods, but especially the god Sin. Again, only coincidentally is it relate to our English word sin, the wilderness of sin, sometimes Zen, was the moon goddess. And so what Nabonidus did was, when he understood the Persians were coming, he gathered all the gods into Babylon from all over the country. Well, this made everybody mad, honestly. First of all, it made all the country folk mad because they were the ones that had these temples out in their towns, and here was a god and here was a goddess to this and that and the other. And that sort of was tourism for their community. It was pride for their community. It was the religion of the community. And he went and he took their god, just like he had done in, like Nebuchadnezzar had done in Judea, and he took them all then and brought them all into Babylon. Now, we think it was probably because he wanted to save these, and he thought he was going to lose the kingdom to Cyrus, and so he's bringing everything to Babylon in order to preserve at least the gold and the ivory and these things, that the precious metals and stones that these were made out of. And so he, first of all, makes all the countryside people mad, but then Babylon is given to the god Marduk, Bel Marduk, and so all the high priests of Marduk, they're mad because they got all this competition coming into town. And all these gods and goddesses are having their parades through town and their processions in, and everybody's looking at it and they're beginning to participate. So he's got the priestly group of Babylon mad at him. He's got the country folk mad at him. And all the while, he's off in Arabia and they're mad at him and mad at him for being gone. And Belshazzar, he from all practical purpose, everything that we can see, he just liked to sit back and enjoy a good time. And he was not a political leader at all. He had been a great military leader at one time, and that's all there was to it. So basically, everybody's mad. Nobody in the kingdom is very happy on what is going on. So what you see in the history records, again, it's a little hard to put this together, but what we believe we see in the history records is Cyrus, his army, actually came in later, but when the army, the generals of Cyrus came, basically they just walked in. There may have been a little bit of a skirmish, but there wasn't much of a skirmish. Certainly there was a little bit because Belshazzar the king was slain that very night. So here's the people. They're having a party. In fact, the Nabonidus Chronicle speaks of the Akitu festival that was going on. So even the secular record says there was this great festival going on when the armies of Cyrus come in, and the people basically just say, "Ah, you can have it. We're good with it." It's almost the same thing's going to happen when the Romans come in take over Judea later on, that we'll even begin to see it when we get into chapter 9 just a little bit. So, the first thing that Cyrus does, Cyrus being, in a sense, a great politician, Cyrus says, "Y'all can have all your gods back." Well, guess what? Now, everybody loves him. In fact, having said, "You can have the sin god back, you can have the Marduk god, you can have all these gods back," and then, really by appointment of God, but he might have gotten himself into the appointment of God unknowingly, he almost has to say, "Oh yeah, you Jews, you can have your stuff back too, and you can go back to your temple and put it back there. Rebuild the temple like I'm letting it happen all over the kingdom." And this is all in the design, even in the prophecy of God. Again, we'll look at some more of this. So that night, Belshazzar was slain. It reminds me again of the man who built those barns and bigger barns, and the Lord said, "Thou fool, tonight thy soul is required of thee." And Darius the Median took the kingdom, being about 62 years old. Now you say, "Well, I thought it was Cyrus." And it was. And this is given a little bit of head scratching as well, that who's Darius the Mede? There's going to be some other Dariuses later that are different than Darius the Mede. So remember, Darius the Mede is not the same as some Dariuses we're going to see later on. There's Darius the First and Darius the Second and Darius the Mede. Darius the Mede, we're not really sure who he was. Cyrus is the king now, but Cyrus is giving governorships, and we're convinced this was probably one of his generals or his governors that was then took that particular part of the kingdom at 60 years of age, and there's a little bit of debate about that. And with that, then, you come to the end of Babylon. You come to the conclusion of the kingdom of Babylon. Of course, you're going to now have the kingdom of the Medes and the Persians, and then the Greeks, and then the Romans, and we'll see all that play out. Now, since we just ending Nebuchadnezzar's kingdom and the kingdom of Babylon, it does seem appropriate for me to remind you that Dispensational Publishing has printed a book called Future Babylon, by Dr. Charles Dyer. And it's the biblical arguments for the rebuilding of Babylon. And it will go along with much of what we have said here. And yet it's about the future. And tonight we've been talking about the past. Now you can get it on Amazon or have your bookstore order it. Or, of course, what I prefer is dispensationalpublishing.com. Now let me tell you what I've done. This is Thursday, Friday, Saturday. I went in and I made this almost half price, $6.99. If you want to get it, now's the time to do it. I'm not advertising it anywhere. You just have to watch this Bible study and catch it before Saturday night. So Future Babylon, $6.99. It goes along with what we're talking about here, which is why I wanted you to see this. Now, one other thing that I would like to let you know about, there is a silent movie that you might want to watch sometime. It's from 1919. You'll have a little history of movies and a little history of Babylon. And the silent movie is called Intolerance, D.W. Griffith's Intolerance. Now, there are four sections, and you want to watch the section on Babylon. You can watch the whole thing if you want. But I will show you just a little bit here. There's some music that has been put to it. The original music track has been lost through the years, and it's a silent movie anyway, so it doesn't matter that you can't hear this. But it goes through and talks about the jealous priests of Bel and gives some pictures. Now, this particular part right here, hi, how are you doing? This little part right here, is going to, I believe, show us the gates of the city of Babylon. Here we go. No enemy had ever been able to force, and they're going to open up these gates, and as they open up these gates, there's going to be the procession then of the gods that are coming in into Babylon. And though I have to tell you, I haven't watched the entire thing, but from what I have seen and what I have studied on it, I think that D.W. Griffith did his homework pretty well. And here's the handmaids of Ishtar's daughter. They come in, Ishtar coming into the city of Babylon, and looks like it has switched us to an advertisement there. So that is our Bible study tonight. I've gone over a few minutes here, surprise, surprise, but I would be happy to take some of your questions. And as I do that, as you put your questions in, let me remind you that we have a Bible conference retreat coming up Labor Day weekend, September 2, 3, and 4. You can go to randywhiteministries.org, look in the upper right-hand corner and click that retreat button. And our subject this year is the ministry of Jesus, graphically presented, and we'll have charts and graphs all the way through, much like the book last year that is still available, The Bible Graphically Presented, and the recordings are available. And we'll just have a great time of fellowship and fun in Branson, Missouri over Labor Day weekend. It starts noon Saturday, goes through noon Monday. And so if you're within a half day's drive, you don't even have to take off a day of work, and would be so happy to have you join us for that time there. And now let's see if you've got some questions here. And we have, let's see, what's that movie called again? Intolerance, I believe it is. And I did put on the outline, somewhere on the outline, on the first page, I put 1919 on your outline. I believe it's 1916. The movie is Intolerance, D.W. Griffith, and I've got a YouTube address there that you'll have to try to get right with all those letters and numbers there. Or you can just go to YouTube and search Intolerance, the movie, the silent movie. You'll find it, and I might enjoy watching it. What language was the writing of the wall in? Now, I believe, let's go to verse 25 and look at this. I believe that it was in the Aramaic language, just as the rest of it is. But let's see if we have any agreement here. Okay. It is... Here's the root word. Interestingly, that Strong's does not have it, although some of the Aramaic words Strong's does not have. So Okay, here's the root word to count or to install, and used about 8 times, it looks like, that particular root word. Here we go. We'll have to ignore some of this, but if we go to the King James Version, all in Ezra and Daniel, the root word being number, I'm going to say it's in Aramaic, just for the fact that you've got these root words that are used, for example, Ezra chapter 6, verse 17, 12, according to the number of the tribes of Israel, 12 he-goats. I was trying to get my eyes working there. According to the number of the tribes of Israel, so numbered or set magistrates, that is, numbered magistrates, ordained, numbered. In fact, we looked at that, Daniel chapter 2, verse 24. He numbered them to destroy. So it is Aramaic, which again is, there's one sentence in there that makes it appear that not, and all the other sentences make it appear that they were able to read it and know what it said. They just didn't know what it meant. And so this was the issue that was given there. Thank you. And let's see. Any idea why verse 25 uses upharsin, but 28 uses paris? Interesting. Glad you mentioned that, because I did not catch that as I was going through, even though I know now you are exactly right. So good way to question the assumptions. And let's just look at Hebrew right here. And, okay. This is what I thought. Parson is the word here. Let's just see if this is a translation issue. Paris. Okay. I'm going to noun common, singular, absolute. I have a feeling noun common, masculine, plural, absolute. Okay. That's what I was thinking, is it was just a form of the word. Same word, actually, and in English we don't have these different forms of the word for different uses, but this one is plural and this one is singular. Now, why is that? And that's a thing that Young's did not carry through, which is one of the reasons why, when you get to words like this, it's probably better just to use the word and let people roll up their own sleeves and do a little work. But numbered, weighted, and divided. I think this happens to be one of these things that we don't have a plural for divided, and what does this actually mean, and how does it come across? But best I can do, great question, best I can do is say we got plural here and we've got singular here. Why, I am not sure. Bob, thank you for the word there on that particular silent movie, Intolerance. It's part 4 that you want to watch if you don't want to watch the entire 3-plus-hour movie. Part 4, I believe, is about an hour that is there. Thank you, each one of you, for joining us tonight as we've walked through this chapter. We've got one more historical chapter, and that's chapter 6. And then beginning with verse 7, we have prophetic chapters. So we're going to carry through the chronology through chapter 6, and then beginning in chapter 7, we're going to have to go back and put those, layer them on top of the chronology that we've been learning and studying. And of course, knowing the underlying history and the context is going to help us to interpret 7 through chapter 12. Beth, let me go ahead and answer her question. Not on Daniel, but it says John 17, 1 through 3. Any idea why Jesus is talking about himself and then switches to first person in chapter 17, verse 4. Let's go to that. And I always worry a little bit when someone brings up 1st, 2nd, 3rd John, especially 1st John or the Gospel of John. And in the Gospel of John, especially chapter 16 and 17, they're not easy, but let's see what we can do. The words of Jesus lifted up his eyes eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify thy Son, that thy Son may glorify thee. First person. Or speaking in the third, but about himself, as thou hast given him power over all the flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as thou hast given him. And this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. So he's speaking of himself in the third person. I have glorified thee on earth. I have finished the work which thou gavest me to do. Oh, now and now, Father, glorify thou me. Now, the question is, why does he switch to from talking about himself to in the third person? Why does he switch from third person to first person? And I don't know. it's a good question here, as he refers really to the work that he has done, but then immediately goes into almost self-defense is probably not the right word here, but I have glorified thee, I have finished the work which thou gavest to do. Oh, now, Father, glorify thou me with thine own self. I don't know. Let me look into that, see if I can find anything. If anyone else comes up with some brilliant thought there too, whether it's just happens to be, again, one of these points of historical validity, because this is kind of the way you and I talk. We sort of switch back and forth between persons like this, and Jesus is a real person. This wasn't a speech he prepared ahead of time that is given there. So that's one possibility. Again, I don't know the exact answer, but thanks for thinking, Beth, in a good question like that. I'd love to hear from any of you, randy@randywhiteministries.org. If you send an email and I haven't answered, send it back. Sometimes those get lost, and I will remind you that we have just Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, Future Babylon, $6.99, available at dispensationalpublishing.com. Just go there and search the word Future Babylon, and you will find it, and you won't find it at that price, I can promise, anywhere else but dispensationalpublishing.com. Autumn, we're glad you're here. Even though you have missed some, we want to welcome you and any others who may be new with us. Thank you, and God bless you. Let me lead us in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for the opportunity we have to study the Word of God and this fascinating time in history, a time that's marked on our world so much that we know the state is the saying, handwriting on the wall. Heavenly Father, it appears to us it could be written for the United States or the Western world or life as we know it even. And we just are grateful for the grace of God that you have given us in this time and the hope that we can have for the future because he lives. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Look forward to seeing you Sunday live or on the archives as we talk about seven men who rule the world from the grave. And then we'll talk about the kingdom of the gospel, the gospel of the kingdom that Jesus Christ speaks of. Thank you. God bless each one of you. Look forward to having you with us next week for the book of Daniel. Thank you, and you have a great weekend.